So I'm going to talk to you today about the future of learning analytics. And this is a more impassioned talk than it would have been a week ago. Because in the last week, I have realised that if you do not have a vision for the future, you can make really stupid mistakes. And that if you don't look ahead at what is coming up, things can go very badly wrong. And that if you assume somebody else above you is making sensible decisions, you are not necessarily right. So with all that experience, I'm going to talk to you about the future of learning analytics. And I'm going to talk to you about preparing for a future that we don't really know what is coming up. I mean, for many years now, we have said we are preparing our students for a future that does not yet exist and to do jobs that do not yet exist. As you can see from this sort of projection of jobs that might be in 2030, we are educating our students for things that we don't really know about at the moment. So why me to talk to you about the future of learning analytics, coming from a country which clearly knows very little about what is coming up in the future? One of the reasons is I come from the Open University in the United Kingdom. That's the building I work in. My office is on the first floor. We're a distance learning institution. We're the biggest university in the UK with about 200,000 students at the moment. And we've been collecting data about our students since we began, so nearly 50 years ago. We haven't had our students on campus, so any data we could collect about them, we were bringing together and we were trying to use that to improve the learning and teaching experience. And as learning analytics have emerged, we have engaged with learning analytics right from the beginning. We have collected data about our formal students on our undergraduate and postgraduate courses, but also increasingly over the last decade about our informal learners. The informal learners learning by YouTube, by iTunes U, by OpenLearn, and more recently by the FutureLearn MOOC platform, which we initiated. But more specifically around learning analytics, and more specifically for this talk, I've been involved in two European projects which are just coming to an end. The first one is the LASI project, which many of you in this room know about, the Learning Analytics Community Exchange. It's a European community support action. It's been bringing together people around Europe, telling them about learning analytics, helping them to go on to the next stage with learning analytics, building networks around learning analytics. And that project comes to an end of its funding in 2 days' time, when it will become part of the Society for Learning Analytics Research, which will become a special interest group, so it will have less money, but it will still be there. And one of the things that we've done as part of that project is we've looked ahead at the future of learning analytics to see what's coming up in the decade. Now, overlapping with that, we've had another shorter project which has just come to an end called the LEAP project, which stands for Learning Analytics for European Educational Policy. And that has been thinking about, okay, we have some idea of what's coming up in the future, how can European policy make a difference to that? So I'm going to be talking to you about those two things. I always like to sort of talk about terminology before I start. We talked yesterday, Christabel talked about all the different forms of educational data science, really focusing in here on learning analytics. And I'd say there are two stages to learning analytics. There's the one where we collect the data, we process the data, we analyse the data. And then there's the other really important stage where we take it to the learners and the teachers and we use it to improve what's going on with learning and teaching. And until that we've done that stage, we haven't really done learning analytics. We've done the first part, but not the second part. So as we're thinking about the future, we need to think more and more about how we are really applying our work and moving it from being research into practice, which is genuinely benefiting learners and teachers. So I'm going to talk to you about, first, about the LASI project's visions of the future study. So we're interested in what is going to happen to learning analytics within the next 10 years. And to investigate that, we carried out the policy Delphi study. Now, some of you may have been involved with Delphi studies in the past. The Delphi study brings together expert views, big range of expert views, and tries to synthesize them to get one absolutely expert opinion. And that's very important, you know, if you have to make a big decision together. But we didn't want to do that. We wanted to do a policy Delphi, which collects a wide range of expert views, and then it passes them on to policymakers and says, this is the range of opinions. Based on that range of opinions, you make decisions about policy. So to get that range of expert views, we produced 8 visions of the future. Now, I saw somebody presented these last week, and they went up on Twitter as the LASI visions of the future. They're not, strictly speaking, the LASI visions of the future. They are provocations. They are things which might happen in the future, given what we know at the moment. But they're not necessarily things we want to happen in the future. They're not necessarily things we want to work towards. They're things that could happen. So we produced these 8 visions, and then we presented them to experts from around the world and people in the learning analytics community more generally through a survey. And we said, look at least 3 of these visions and tell us about them. Tell us if you think they're desirable. Are they visions we want to work towards? Are they feasible? Could we work towards them? Might they happen even if we don't? And what actions do we need to take on the basis of that? So when we've done that, we've got a big report. You can download the report at that bit.ly URL if you want to look at the whole thing. So I'm going to give you just a flavour of some of the things that came up there and some of the things you might want to think about. And I think it's worth considering as I go through the visions, which of these futures aligns with your work? Can you see your work building towards one of those futures, or are you building towards a different future? Or have you not really thought about which future you're working towards? Are you really focused on your work? In which case, time to sort of lift your head up and think, what's the next stage? So provocations, the visions we produced, were about 100 to 120 words long. I'm not going to put those all up on big screens for you to read. That would be terribly boring. I'm just going to give you the headings, and I'm going to give you some of the responses that we got from experts to show you some of the issues that come up around these. So the first vision is that learners are monitored by their learning environments. And we know that this is happening increasingly now. We see much more use of video going on within our classrooms. We see audio recording going on within our classrooms. We begin to see facial recognition taking place in our classrooms. But as the Internet of Things develops, almost anything within our classroom could begin to talk to the internet, could begin to send back messages. It could say, Rebecca has picked up this glass now. Rebecca has moved this glass over here. Not very useful for a glass, but when you're talking about equipment you're using within experiments, for example, that begins to be information you can feed into learning analytics. So we face in the next 10 years a possible explosion of the data that we can use in learning analytics. And we've already got a lot of data. So what would we do with even more data? How can we make use of that? So these are some of the responses that we got. Some people see it as a really promising way forward. They're interested in what we can do with these sensors. They're interested in what they can put sensors into and how they can tell things about the students. But a really big response, and we got this on every single one of the visions, was the idea of alienation and was the idea of Big Brother. People were scared by the idea that somebody is watching them through that video camera, that video footage is going somewhere, perhaps to somebody they don't want to see it, perhaps to somebody they don't want to be controlling them, perhaps to somebody that they don't want to be in charge of education. And I think we as a learning analytics community have to be aware of this very real fear that we see with students and that we see with teachers and that we see emerging from the learning analytics experts. Now, if we collect data, who is making use of that data? And how do we make sure it's being used sensibly? And how do we make the end user aware of how it's being used? Because there are fundamental human factors at play here, as somebody said. The second vision, sort of related to that, another big source of data is the beginnings of personal data being tracked. I don't know if some of you in the room are wearing Fitbits or something like that, which tracks your steps. If you're runners, perhaps you've got ones which track your heart rate and things like that. You see more and more people making use of these. And we can see that data begins to be picked up and used in learning analytics. So we had a project at our university where they were working at traders on the stock market floor, traders who had to make sort of multi-billion decisions very quickly, and it was teaching them to make decisions calmly and not in a fit of excitement. And part of that work involved fitting them with sensors for 24 hours to get a sense of when they were excited, when they were calm, how they could keep that under control. So we're already seeing that use of sensors coming in. That picture there is my son 5 years ago. If you look at this blue ball here, floating in the air, sort of jet of air actually, he's controlling how that moves with his brain waves. He's thinking left and right, and it is moving it through that obstacle course. That is a game that you can buy on eBay for about 40 euros. And that was 5 years ago. So really big possibilities coming up for telling how people are reacting to things and even what they're thinking. And again, people can see lots of possibilities there, particularly, of course, the possibilities for health education. If we know what's going on in people's bodies, we can perhaps help them to make better decisions. And the quantified self, if you've not come across the quantified self movement, people making records of these sorts of measurements and using them to reflect on what they're doing and perhaps to change what they're doing. So that's a big movement which people are doing themselves, which can be incorporated within learning analytics. But this idea of a reliable evidence base is something that we don't really have in learning analytics. We might be able to say our learning analytics are reliable in this particular context at this particular time, but can we make bigger claims for them? And we're going to need to begin to make bigger claims for them, so how do we build that evidence base? Now the third provocation, the third vision, is a sort of dystopian one from our perspective. Analytics are rarely used. And that image there is from a website in America, Help Fight In Bloom. I don't know who knows about the In Bloom project. The In Bloom project cost the Gates Foundation $100 million. And the In Bloom project brought together data from school students in various areas across the US, and the idea was that you could analyze this, use the data for the good of the students. But they didn't tell parents, they didn't engage the parents, they didn't engage the local community, they didn't necessarily engage the teachers. They became very suspicious. They said it's funded by the Gates Foundation, it must all be going to Bill Gates, we don't like Bill Gates. We've realised that schools hold lots of data about our children, about their ethnicity, about their abilities, about their disabilities, about what they can do. We don't want Bill Gates to have that. Huge public campaign, and the entire £100 million project crashed. Right. So there is the possibility for this to happen. We only need this to happen once or twice more, and we can see analytics as a whole crashing. And we as a community have a responsibility to avoid that happening, I think. So one of the things that comes out of that is the strong need for ethical discussion and ethical debate, which if you come to my workshop later today, you will be having. And that's one of the reasons we're having so many discussions at the moment about the ethics of learning analytics, because it is a big worry for people. And not just we are doing no harm, I mean, the central aspect of ethics is do no harm. But also, we need to be shown we're doing good. Can we concretely show the benefits? Can we show that we're doing something that works better than what the teacher was doing in the first place? How can we put the learner at the centre of the analytics rather than, as it is at the moment quite often, the researcher at the centre of the learning analytics? Linked to that one, the issue of who has control of the data. And many people feel strongly that learners should control the data, that it's their data, that they produced it. But is it their data? Or does it belong to the groups of learners working together? Or does it belong to the teacher, the educator, who provoked them to do those things? Or does it belong to the institution? Once we know who it belongs to, what should they be doing about it? If we said it belongs to the individuals, do they know what to do about it if they can't manage the money in their pockets? You know, managing data is a complicated business. And do users really want us to sit them down and tell them everything we're going to do with their data? Which would be extremely boring, especially if we kept coming back to them and saying, another thing I'm doing with the data. If we have control over to the students, then that gives us a huge job to get all the data in and to collect that data. And we won't necessarily ever get all the data in, so we won't be able to make informed decisions about an entire group. So there's issues to balance here. How do we get data protection right? How do we get data ownership right? Are these discussions we need to make once, or do we need to keep returning to these decisions? Provocation 5, this is linked with some discussions I've had with the University of Scotland. They said, we decided to bring in learning analytics across our institution, and we went to a commercial company. We spent thousands on a learning analytics system. We were really pleased with it. We were about to roll it out, and the company went bust. But we didn't have an open system. It didn't talk to other systems. So they couldn't use any of that, so they had to start again. So they went to another company and they said, we want learning analytics, and they introduced learning analytics and they spent more thousands. And that was going really well for 6 months, until that company said, we're pulling out of learning analytics. And then all that money was wasted again, and they had to go to another company. So there are advantages to using open systems, systems that talk to each other, systems that we can all build on together. But we need standards if we're going to do that. We need the same term to refer to the same thing in different situations. We need to think on a national level, on an inter-institutional level. We can't just be thinking about that in our one institution or in our one research group. We need to be talking to other people. And we need to be thinking, is open really the right way to go? Do we want commercial companies to be doing this because commercial companies can perhaps work faster, they're more agile, they're more driven? Perhaps we need to go that way, but do we need to prompt them, push them in a certain direction? This is perhaps a view that people in the learning analytics community are moving towards. Learning analytics are essential tools, each learner standing on a pile of little tiny bits of data which are raising them up. Will we have that in the future? Well, we might have, but we need to think about it. And we need to think about what we mean by learning and how learning happens. And that was one of the subjects of the last talk in this room. We need learning theory underpinning our learning activity. Because it's all very well to develop analytics which stop our students failing at all if one of the key things about learning is learning through failure. It's no good endlessly prompting them with little nudges if they never then reflect on what they're doing and make their own decisions. So we need to think about how learning takes place before we think about what analytics we really want to use. What do we want to support our learners to do? What skills do we want them to develop? I think this provocation is the one which is closest to my heart. Analytics help learners to make the right choices. They don't do everything for them, but they say, you know, if you go in that direction, this will happen. If you go in that direction, this will happen. But not everybody agrees with me. Some people think that's not the way to go. Institutional change is very slow. Do we want to move in that direction? Can we move in that direction? Are we just going to be forced in that direction because we run out of money and everyone says, well, let's have analytics because analytics are cheaper than teachers? That's not the right route we want to go through. We don't want to limit things. We want to keep things as wide as possible and people learning as well as possible. And then provocation eight. Analytics have largely replaced teachers. And there is a saying that any teacher who can be replaced by a robot should be replaced by a robot. Any teacher who can be replaced by analytics perhaps should be replaced by analytics, but that's not really a very friendly vision. Certainly when you put it to analytic experts, many of whom are teachers. So people can see the advantages to personalised learning, where you know everybody gets their own take on learning, where they make their own decisions, where they're autonomous. There are great advantages there, but what does it mean to take the teacher out of the equation, and do we even want to take the teacher out of the equation, and are we accidentally going down the route which takes the teacher out of the equation, which we don't want to? So those were the provocations. I don't know if any of them tallied with where you think you're going with your research, where you think your university is going with learning analytics. But if none of them tallied with it, think about where you are going with it. What future are you working towards? Because there isn't anybody at the top saying this is the future we're working towards. We're all making that future. So that was the LACE Visions of the Future project, and as I say, if you there's a link, you can go and look at the entire report if you're interested to follow that up further. So I'll now take us on to the LEAP project, and the LEAP project was thinking about European policy and how we as Europe can move towards learning analytics implementation and the sort of learning analytics implementation we want. And there is a vision. I don't know if you know the European vision for education and training. Who knows what the European priority areas for education and training are? Hands up. Does anybody know one of them? Okay. Somebody might know one of them. There's a possibility somebody in the room might know one. Yes. All of us go for European funding, don't we? All of us go for European funding in education and training. So why do none of us know what Europe is trying to achieve? It's interesting, isn't it? I didn't know until I went and looked it up. These are some of the things we are trying to achieve in Europe. And if you look at them, you can see that some of these would align really well with your grant proposal. So it's well worth writing into your next grant proposal, because the reviewers will be going, ah, oh, yes, they're doing exactly what we want. I wonder how that happened. Learning analytics, open and innovative education and training, fully embracing the digital era. Absolutely, learning analytics, we can take that one up, we can take that one forward, that's great. Strong support for the teachers and the trainers and the school leaders and the other educational staff. We could do that. Are we necessarily doing that? Is your research doing that at the moment? You put your hand on your heart and say your research is really doing that. Or just have the possibility to do it. The high quality knowledge. Well, I'd say most of us are working on learning analytics to support knowledge building, knowledge acquisition, participation in knowledge communities. But are we doing much about skills? And are we doing much about competencies? Because as a learning analytics community, we have to deal with all these priority areas. How can we support all of these? And you can begin to see gaps when you look at this level. And you begin to think, oh, we could fill that gap. Nice little niche for our institution. Nice little niche for our research group. And these ones about learning outcomes. Well, I know very small groups who are working on employability, innovation, citizenship, well-being, inclusive education. But generally speaking, in the learning analytics field, we're not doing very much there at the moment. So that is a direction that we might want to be moving in. We might want to be thinking, that's the next stage for learning analytics. So with those in mind, the Lake Project thought about, okay, what needs to happen next? We looked at what is the current state of the art. So we looked at the literature about implementation of learning analytics. We brought together an inventory of the tools and practices and policies in learning analytics. And we carried out some case studies around the world. And then we thought about what are the prospects for the future. We ran an expert workshop. We had 50 experts gathered in Amsterdam. I think some people in this room were involved, talking about where do we go? And then how can we develop European policy which supports us to do that? How do we develop things at European level? How do we move at European level? And we came up with a 7-point framework: strategy, R&D, infrastructure, context, standards, skills, and outreach. And I would say most of us are working on research and development. People in this room are working on outreach, but not very many people are working on outreach necessarily. But some of these others, they're a bit less well represented. So we've come out with a whole plan. The plan's going to be published in autumn, I think. It's with the reviewers at the moment. So I'll give you a sort of preview of what's coming up in that plan. It's phrased at European level, but I've phrased them here as things you could do within your institution. In terms of strategy, right, I've shown you what the European priority areas are. Do you know what priority areas within your university, your institution are? Where are they going? What are they trying to achieve? It might be the thing they write on the front of the student handbook. It might be the thing they've got in the business plan. But your university management are going in one direction. Is your learning analytics strategy going in the same direction? Is it supporting that, or is it going against it? Where do you want to go with learning analytics? You know what's happening in your project. What's happening next? What's happening in parallel projects? What are you going to be doing in 5 years' time? What are you going to be doing in 10 years' time? What are you building towards? If you build a plan like this, you can map it out and bring it together. Have you got somebody who's in charge of learning analytics? I must say, in our institution, we have lots and lots of little projects going. And then one of the Pro Vice Chancellors took charge. Suddenly it all made sense and everything started to happen because there was support at a high level. Can you bring in that support at a high level? Something we're all doing here, identifying and building on working related areas, talking to other countries. The more we can talk to other people about what's going on with their work, the less we duplicate things. And the learning analytics community certainly duplicates things. The more learning analytics events and conferences I go to, the more I realise that loads of people are working on the same problem, but not necessarily talking to each other. And once we've done all that, once we've reached our priorities, once we've achieved what we want, then let's think about the next stage. Because this isn't something we just get there and we finish, we keep going. In terms of R&D, and that's the area most of us are involved in, are we covering all those areas? Are we developing pedagogy which makes use of our learning analytics? Are our analytics addressing strategic priorities, or are they just addressing the data that we happen to have? Or a fairly straightforward problem that we think we can solve? Are we taking on the tricky issues? What technology do we need to support the real rollout of this at scale? What frameworks do we need to support the rollout of this at scale? In terms of infrastructure, we certainly need to be able to increase our data handling capability, not just in our institutions, but nationally. We're beginning to see national rollouts in places like Denmark and Norway. They're beginning to pull together information from across the country in ways that can be interrogated by researchers and by teachers. But that means we need organisational structures to support how does the data get there, how does the data get used, and how do we care for that data. The Evidence Hub pet project of the LASI project, there's a link up there. The LASI project is bringing together research evidence around learning analytics so that you can interrogate it. So you can say, is there actually any evidence that learning analytics support learning? Is there any evidence that they support teaching in schools? Is there any evidence at all from Uruguay? And you can go and you can look at the Evidence Hub and you can ask it these questions and you can add to it. So I do encourage you to put your own research in there so that other people can find it and to make use of it, ask it questions. And we need to work harder on methods of sharing experience and good practice. This is a good start, but how many researchers can't get here and how do we bring them in? In terms of context, something that we've been aware of in the LASI project is that people are working in different sectors and different sectors have different needs. We're very focused on higher education. Fewer people working in schools, and people like you who are working in schools have found that there's different things that you have to prioritise. People working in the workplace have found there's not very much going on, and what is going on is very secret because it's quite commercially sensitive. So we need to think about how we can share insights and how we can adapt things to contexts. Also, we do need to think about these successful financial models. I think possibly we don't think about them as researchers because that's, you know, something they do up above us. But unless we can make a strong justification for people spending the money on research and development and technology infrastructures and skill training, what are they getting in return for all that investment? Are they getting a good return on investment? And if they're not getting a good return, why should they do it? We have to be able to make that case. Lots of stuff coming up on standards. Obviously, this is a big thing that can be done at European and national level, but it's worth thinking about at our level. Even with our, in our institutions, interoperability standards are a tricky thing to do. We had a case last year in our institution. We said, how many students have we got at the Open University? Well, you would think that is the most basic piece of information, wouldn't you? I mean, what university would not know how many students it had? So we asked the registration department, and they gave us one number, and then we asked the exams department, and they gave us a very different number, because the number of people who registered were not necessarily the number of people who were there 3 to 6 months later. And as a distant university, it's quite difficult to pick up on when people drop out of the course, unless they send you an email to say they've dropped out. So we had to choose whose figure was the correct figure, or the figure we were going to work with. And that happens across institutions as we begin to build big databases. It's no good saying, I've got a whole set of learners here, and they're getting 90% success rates. And I've got a whole set of learners here, and they're only getting 50% success rates. Let's put them all together in our big learner box without realising that these are postgraduates and these are six-year-olds. Right. If we are labelling things in the same way, they need to be broadly similar things. We definitely need ethical standards and data protection. We'll be talking about that later today. If our analytics aren't aligned with what we're doing in assessment, we might as well forget it, because students and teachers are very driven by what happens in assessment. And the quality assurance process. We haven't really begun to address this as a community. We need to think about. Because if we could demonstrate that our analytics are reliable and valid with one cohort, are they reliable and valid with the next cohort? If I say these five learners are at risk, are these five learners really at risk? And if I use the same algorithm in 5 years' time, I get six learners at risk, will they still be learners at risk? Will it still be working? And if I take that algorithm to another institution, will it work? How do we test it? Teachers aren't going to be able to look at the algorithm every single time it runs and go, oh, hang on, that variable doesn't apply anymore. So how do we quality assure this really important issue? surprisingly, nobody seems to have done the work around skills. I often go to talks where they say, we need more skilled people in learning analytics. We don't have enough researchers. We don't have enough developers. And sure, we don't have enough researchers and developers. We also don't have enough teachers who can read the visualizations, and enough learners who can make sense of the visualizations and interpret whether they're reliable and how far we can go with them. And we don't have enough educational leaders who are numerate enough to make these decisions. So how do we get people to a stage where they understand the information and the implications of it? And the final one here, outreach. Again, something we're doing here, but how do we engage more stakeholders? How do we bring in people from other parts of Spain? How do we bring in people, other Spanish speakers? How do we bring in the people who couldn't get here today? How do we bring in commercial organisations? You know, if we're just talking to academics, that's not enough. We need to be talking to lots of people, lots of communities. And we need people to be aware of what's going on in learning analytics. So everybody in this room knows what learning analytics are. But if we went out into the wider university, picked 30 students at random and said, tell me about learning analytics, what would they say? Would any of them say, I understand what learning analytics are? Would one of them say that? Well, until they all know what it is, we haven't really succeeded. So I sort of whizzed through what we could be doing in the future. I'd say the overall message at this stage is stay connected. You're connected here, but stay connected in all sorts of different ways. Engage with the Society for Learning Analytics Research, the International Society. Engage with the LAC conferences, LASI events like this one. Stay in touch with the LACE organisation, which is bringing people together across Europe. Make your own connections, keep it all going. Keep talking to each other. Who is that institution that's got a vision for learning analytics? Who is in a department that has got a vision for learning analytics? Who would say SNOLA has a vision for learning analytics? Who would say the Spanish Network of Learning Analytics has got a vision for learning analytics? But you are that network. Have you got that vision?
I think we're getting to it.
Would anybody care to say what an element of that vision might be?
One of the keys that you showed us is that what we do has to be useful to improve the learning and teaching. I mean, that we have to have that in mind, not only for research, to test, to pilot, to experiment, but really useful, and it has to reach the classroom, and not only the university classroom, but also the students. So we have to find a way to spread our results.
Any other elements of vision? Where should the network be going? Where do you want the network to be in 5 years' time, 10 years' time? What will you have achieved? Because if you don't know what you're trying to achieve, you're going to struggle to achieve it.
Yes. For me, the long-term vision should be aligned with informing all these stakeholders, especially higher education institutions, but not only, also the ministry, to get a global vision from the country, what all the spaces in learning knowledge is. Because, you know, you already said it, yeah, I think just also talked about it yesterday, it's not the same performing and informing about learning analytics in higher education or a primary school, because also the data you get is different, the problematic is completely different. But I think that our main idea should be informing those up above that there's something called learning analytics, how can it improve learning, although we have to prove that it improves learning, but that would be the main idea. If we don't get people to get that vision, and we don't transmit the vision to others, then everything we do is just isolated experience. Mm.
And so as you identify these elements of the vision, that begins to tell you the things that the network can do. If one of the things you want to do is you need to talk to the government, or you need to be producing white papers for the government. If one of the things you want to do is take learning analytics into schools, you need to be thinking more and more about how can we take learning analytics into schools.
Another thing we are working on, and you also commented, is about addressing together common challenges. I mean, not repeating again the same projects in each institution, and bringing together what we have in common and how we can collaborate with our own experience. And that is something that we are starting to work in the network, and that we want to open also to the international level, so we don't redo once and again the same things. So,
and that could be a really important contribution, that you identify in Spain what the challenges are next for learning analytics, and then you take those out internationally and challenge everybody to take those up and engage with them.
And I also think that as researchers, we also have the responsibility to reflect on the consequences of all the factors that we have to take into account and deploy naive approaches to learning analytics, which are different from simple or so. What I want to have in my environment is, you know, thinking that only taking record of what students are doing will be good for their learning. There are many things that we have to take into account, and the visions are, for example, one idea of what we have to think about, you know, things that have pros and cons. That's our responsibility as well, because we have to meet other people. We are researchers, and our mission has to be a little bit to think about, to make people reflect, to provide solutions, but maybe we need to put together other people that have other responsibilities. We cannot do everything.
But it's also something we can do inside the community.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
If you're thinking of developing a postgraduate course, people were telling me yesterday that's the direction you're thinking of going. Building in that reflection is important. Workshops for doctoral students can be really important in promoting that reflection. I mean, that's one of the things that SNOLA is trying to do at international level. But of course, the amount of postgraduate students who can get to SNOLA events is quite small. So if we're doing that more locally as well, that's a great advantage.
I mean, this is not about the visions of SNOLA, because I don't know that much, and I'm not in the network itself. But so I just wanted to share one thing we had. Like, we had a workshop just before, that's why some of us were a bit late, and I apologize. So it was striking to me, because the workshop was about having teachers and researchers and system developers to talk about their analytics and trying to achieve a common vision for a particular context and so on. And one of the main conclusions that all the groups that were small groups working on these different problems on the same direction is actually there was a lot of, so they achieved a common vision, but there was kind of like the common intuition or fear that actually implementing that would be too expensive, or too expensive given the benefit that has actually not been demonstrated yet for learning. So, like, I don't know if you have seen any of that in your visions of the future, or what's your reaction to that kind of vision? Like, the vision, for example, in Spain, I guess, like, the version of that vision would be, oh, maybe learning analytics is too expensive to do here, because for the value we get out of it. So what would be your reaction to that vision, maybe?
I'd say there's several things about that. I mean, the idea of that financial models definitely came up. One of the things that you can do, I mean, this is happening in the UK, the GISC organisation is working across the UK to develop learning analytics pilots, and so it's spreading the expense across a lot of institutions, which then begins to make it more possible. and if there were liaison between Spain and GIST to, well, how could we extend this in Spain, then that begins to spread the cost even further, because I know that war institutions are very short of cash at the moment. We need to really be offering value for money. And I think the other thing we need to do as researchers is to look ahead. When we begin a piece of research, think, okay, this is as most successful it possibly can, how much time and money will it save? If it's going to take all this work to predict those five people are going to drop out, and then I go into the classroom and say to the teacher, which ones do you think are going to drop out? And they pick those five students. That wasn't a very good use of resources. So we do need to think ahead about how we can add value. It's not just about us developing some cool algorithms. I mean, that's a useful thing to do, and we do need to do it. And if that's our intention, we need to say what we're really focused on is the algorithms. But if what we're really focused on is helping those learners, then we need to show value in that area.
Experience with industry, because yesterday we were discussing about how to integrate industry in the network, their vision also, and their kind of
collaboration. Okay. If you look at the LASI website, there's a strand of the LASI project which is focused on workplace learning, which is led by Fabrizio Cardinali in Naples, somewhere in Italy, but he can advise on that. He can tell you what's going on, so get in touch.
Okay. Regarding that, I think that there was something perhaps missing in that vision. It was hinted in one slide. Get companies to work with us. They're much more flexible than institutions. But I know there's also a big concern of big corporations like Pearson and such deploying their systems. Yeah, they can monetize better than that because they have a commercial vision. But I don't know, losing control of that education, giving them all the data for the systems. Mm. Well, I think it's pretty big, scary.
Yeah,
and it's a concern that we as researchers should have and should be aware that it's a peril.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the things that the open systems movement is trying to move in that direction. There's an organisation called the Aperio Foundation, which works at international level, which is working towards open learning analytics. So if you're interested in that, they're good people to get in touch with. And I think we also need to be pushing the commercial companies in terms of what they're doing. Because quite often I look at what the companies are doing, and they're doing something called learning analytics, but in fact it just means here is a load of bar charts that you can work through, and no clue as to what you would do once you've worked through those. So giving them a steer in what direction to go into could be a good one.
Yeah, but they're much better at showing off that they are adding value.
But they're always going to be much better at showing off.
But for example, if we in Spain, we know which are the priorities, mm-hmm. and if you go to institutions and say, well, I'm improving learning, they will laugh at you. I mean, they will ask, how much does it cost? How much do I save? How many students can you help from dropping because I want to improve my ratios? Yeah. But they won't care if you're actually improving learning.
Sad,
isn't it? Yeah, well, that's my pessimistic vision, but
I think in Spain, we have to approach in a different way. So you will be the first university in Spain to implement learning analytics, or in the Basque country, or in Bilbao, the first one, and then they will do it. They don't care about what you do, if it is useful or not.
Yeah.
Another question is that, so I think that our vision is typically that we live in a bubble. So the university is in a bubble with a lot of walls. So then we have data inside the bubble, and then we process this data, we make some fancy things, and that's all. But then, if we get out of the bubble, then, there is no data. Mm-hmm. If the data is from the learner, and it is the learner who owns the data, I think that it is, he should be the one who decides whether it goes out or not. And I think that we can make very useful things if we allow the data to get out. So a learner typically, maybe he makes he gets a bachelor's degree in this university, then he goes away, he works 5 years, and then he comes back to another university for a master or whatever. I think that also learning analytics can just follow this path and improve the learning process during all his life. I don't know if, because Open University is the, let's say, the flagship, I would say, in Europe about learning analytics, if there is any kind of project in this direction.
The project, I don't really know much about this project, but I know there is work going on around blockchain. I can't really get much further than telling you that, you know, if you know about blockchain, you know about it being able to secure your information and link it with your specific ID. And people are beginning to think about how could this be applied to learner information to make it transferable? How could it be used to begin to accredit learners across different institutions, for example? But I'd say that's something to Google rather than something I can tell you anything about.
Yeah, and there is also another point, because we are all talking about this point of, okay, we own our data, we should let the user decide what to do with the data and put a little bit of emphasis on the student. But do we even know how we should proceed with our own data? Because I think that is not the case. So we don't even know who is the owner. We were discussing today, okay, in one of the difficult scenarios, if the teacher is a student in this institution, we don't know who is the owner in many cases. So I think that is a point in terms of, okay, what is my data? What should I do with my data? Kind of training and trying to put in our minds, okay, when I'm putting my data in danger, so I'm overexposing my information, I'm not. And also after that, there is also a point of data literacy. Okay, I'm sharing my data and getting feedback, but I don't know what it means. So I'm improving or not. So I think that we need to support the users in order to better understand where is the performance, whether the algorithm that is behind it can be trusted or not. Mm-hmm. Because it depends also on the context. So some critical thinking about the data that we are collecting and what is the value that we could put towards that direction.
Yeah, and I think that is work we need to be doing internally within the learning analytics community. It's outreach work we need to be doing. We need to be making decisions about how to go forward with this. I mean, I think the more and more we think about learning analytics, it's not just about the research. It's about this whole wider implementation process. And if we as a learning analytics community don't take responsibility for that, it won't happen. It will just stay as little research projects. So we all need to be thinking about how can we move it more widely? You know, how can we be running more of these workshops? How do these workshops work best? What are we aiming them at? Who are we aiming them at? Lots of decisions to make in that direction.
Well, thank you very much. And we go to the coffee break. Remember that we are not coming back to this room. So people with a suitcase, come with me. And the rest, you can go to the coffee break to the place it was yesterday. Okay? Thank you very much.